So I would like to welcome all of you who have been consistently being part of NNF Karnataka GE Masterclass activity, academic activity. So without wasting much of time, let us move to the presentation. So the first presentation will be done by Dr. Fatehpur, who is an associate professor of pediatric at KIMS Hubli, and is a well-known speaker and a well-known personality in Karnataka and quite famous in North Karnataka. Thank you very much for accepting the request of being a speaker. We're going to talk on neonatal growth charts, its importance. So it's going to be a very common topic, but not very much many people know about this. Over to you, sir. You start the session, over to you. And today's session is moderated by Dr. Sohail Ambi. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your
welcome
kind
to,
introduction, sir.
Welcome, welcome,
hello.
Welcome.
Hello, Dr. Dinkar, sir. Thank you.
Welcome, welcome.
Okay. So, first of all, I would like to congratulate the NNFK chapter, Dr. Kotre, sir, Dr. Prashant, and Dr. Dinkar, sir, for their successful webinar programs. It is a huge success, and I also thank them for inviting me as a faculty for this webinar program. So, in the next 30 minutes, I am going to talk about neonatal growth charts. Actually, they had given neonatal growth and including growth charts, but I will be mainly concentrating on neonatal growth charts because since last 5 years, there have been a tremendous development has been taking place. So neonatal growth, and I'll not be talking much about failure of neonatal growth, its management, or its investigations and all. I'll be talking how a neonatal growth should occur. So a growth chart is a graphical design of a growth reference presented as a visual display for clinical use. They comprise of growth curves which display both the size of the newborn at series of ages and at the same time their growth rate or growth velocity over time based on the slope of the curve. We neonatologists or the pediatrician also, whenever a preterm is born, he has to fight against a lot of disorders immediately after birth. Once they are all settled, the child is out of eye fluids, out of oxygen, and is child on full feeds. There are very few issues which he has to consider for the neonate. And one of the important aspect of this diseases is the neonatal growth. Because whenever the neonatal growth is affected, either if it is more or less, there will be long-term complications. So these growth charts have been used since many decades. So the first growth charts, growth curve, which was done, which was charted by was Count Philibert de Montbellard. He had plotted the growth of his own son from birth till 18 years of age, the length of the length of his son. So the same was published by George Buffon. That same chart was published by George Buffon in Histoire Naturelle in the year 1977. 1777. So since then, many have started plotting the growth chart for the children, and even in the they had started plotting the growth charts even for the term and preterm babies also. So out of that, the first one was from the work which was really appreciated by many was from the Lubchenco. He had published the growth charts, intrauterine growth charts, by plotting the birth, the anthropometric measures of all the three, the weight, the length, and the head circumference, from starting from 24 weeks to 42 weeks. And over a period of 12 years, he took a period of 12 years, plotted the graphs for almost, he took the anthropometric measures from almost more than 5,000 children, 5,000 neonates. And he had made that chart and published in the Journal of Pediatrics. So this was one of the first intrauterine growth charts for the neonatal growth chart, which was published and was widely accepted. Based on this, there were many studies also, and they found that when we follow these growth charts, the neonatal outcome, the long-term outcome, especially the neurodevelopmental effects, was very, very improved compared to the other charts. So why we need these growth charts? Mainly for short term, three things. One is for the assessment of size at birth to differentiate whether it is appropriate for gestational age, small for gestational age, or for the large for gestational age. And also for longitudinal monitoring of these preterms, if they gain rapidly or they were very slow to gain because of the many factors, and try to identify as early as possible and try to treat them. And also, when we will be having an assessment of size at hospital discharge, so at the term equivalent age, whether they are still are able to cope up with the growth charts, whether they are able to come to near normal or normal. Okay, so these three short effects we used to find, we have to find in the growth charts. And also for the long term, it will be having a lot of effects, the neurodevelopmental effects, a lot of observational studies they had shown. If we have good growth, especially longitudinal growth in the neonatal period, the neurodevelopmental will be good. And if it is affected, the neurodevelopmental problems would occur in the neonate. And also, if they are grown excessively, they are always prone for the metabolic syndrome, the hypertension, cardiac defects, cardiac disorders. So we should have the growth chart. So how a preterm should go? Whether he has to follow the, what will be the ideal person to be followed, or the ideal cohort of the babies we have to follow. So as early as 1977 itself, the American Academy of Pediatrics had issued statements telling the how the neonates should grow, especially the preterms. So they had told they have to follow the intrauterine growth charts, and they have to be grow as near as to the possible, as near to the 50th centile of the intrauterine growth charts. And also not only the extent of growth, they also told about the they also highlighted the importance of the composition of the growth. Means they are told at that time only, in the year 1977 itself, they should not be overweight. The lean mass of the body tissue should be more than the fat tissue. At that time only they had given the guidelines. So many are still following those guidelines. So we are as of now also, we are trying to make the preterm grow as near to the intrauterine growth rate. Coming to what are the charts available? Till 5 years ago, there were only intrauterine growth charts. But since 5 years, there are a lot of other charts have come, which will help in the understanding how a ideal neonate should grow. So there are a lot of developments, especially after this WHO standardized charts were published. So the people started thinking, so we should not be following the intrauterine, we have to follow the healthy preterm, how it grows, we have to follow that chart. So the types of the charts were based on what basis the preterm should grow. First one is the intrauterine, which is the most common. Then we have the ultrasound standards. Latest one is the longitudinal growth chart. That is the prescriptive standards, which I'll be dealing in detail. And also individualized growth charts, a very new concept, came just 2 years back. And also the bone body mass index charts, which we cannot ignore. So that also I will be telling in a few slides. Before the charts, we have to know two important words. One is the reference chart and the standard chart. So this reference charts and standard charts came into importance once this WHO growth charts were introduced. So what is this growth reference and what is this growth standard. This growth reference, the charts, most of the charts, almost 90% of the charts are made of, are associated with this growth reference. So what are these? These are just descriptive tools. They had taken the data from cross-sectionally from many of the babies who are born. They have taken the measurement. The reference describe newborn size across the range of gestational ages. They included both healthy and unhealthy pregnancies and healthy and unhealthy babies also. And most of them, the data was taken from the medical records. So there was no standardization of any of the things. There was no standardization of which baby to be assigned, whether there was standardization of the gestational age assessment or the standardization of the how to measure, whom to be measured, what instrument to be measured. So there is no standard. So just the data, even some of the studies they have taken the data from the from the what we call just birth chart, birth records in the government. So they have made these intrauterine growth charts. So these are not so much standardized. Even then, we continue to use them. What do you mean by growth standard? So growth standard charts are more of the, as the name tells, it's more of standard. So these are prospective charts, longitudinal charts. So once the baby is born, the preterm baby is born, they have the accurate gestational age assessment from the ultrasound, first trimester ultrasound. They have taken the healthy mothers, the healthy babies, and all the factors which will affect the baby's growth, like even the intrauterine growth retardation, for like PIA, gestational diabetes. Those mothers were ruled out. And after the birth, even if the diseases like NEC or sepsis, which are going to affect the baby's growth postnatally, they are also being ruled out. So they have just taken a cohort of all healthy preterm infants born to healthy mothers, and they have started giving a standardized treatment, and they found they longitudinally they measured the such babies and find plotted them on the growth chart. So there are standardized procedures. So they have instruments, they have for all the people, they have given the same instrument. They have standard operating procedures, how to do the weight, how to do the length, how to do the head circumference. And there are a lot of control measures to minimize the error. So there are a lot of standard procedures are taken to develop these growth standards. The classical example is the WHO growth chart. And the other most important one is that this is a multi-center, means they involved both the developed and developing countries both, as in WHO. Here also in growth standards, they would have involved across many races, many countries like that. So this is the first for preterm growth standard, this preterm postnatal follow-up study of the Intergrowth 21st. This was the recent one which has been published, and I will be talking more about this. Coming to the types of the intrauterine types of the growth charts. The first type is the intrauterine growth charts. This one is the most commonly used and still continue to be used. So there are many published, over a dozen published worldwide, and they continue to be published. Even now in the year 2017, there was a article published by Aris. So as age passes, there are the methods or the whatever the standardized, they kept on increasing. So the methods were improved, the standard operating procedures to plot the charts, and also the other things they have taken care into. But the what are the fallacies or what are the strength of these intrauterine growth charts we'll be studying. So these are the latest ones. I have not taken all the intrauterine growth charts. I have taken only few. So these are the latest ones, Uslan et al., Fenton, which is the most commonly used, and bogus net all and arrays. So they, these different charts, they depended on the methodology in which they have plotted these charts and their intended use, and also the characteristic of the preterm infants for which they have taken, and also the population studies. So almost all the population was mainly in the developed countries, USA and all. Even the Fenton chart, where it is a little bit more standard, though it is a multicentric, all the countries involved in that chart were mainly developed countries. None of the countries were from the developing side. So whether we have to use such charts for our babies, it is still a question. So this is the Fenton charts for both the boys and the girls, and the given different centiles. And they have come even in the apps also. We can download these apps in the iPhone or in the Android-based mobile phones, and we can even plot the charts. So what are the strengths? The strength is mainly the large sample size. So in each of the studies, almost 5,000, 6,000, maybe 10,000 babies are also being charted out. So the large sample size, though it will decrease the errors, but still, what are the limitations? So here, most of the intrauterine growth charts, they use this last menstrual period as the gestational age assessment. So many of us know that taking LMP as a measurement of the gestational age is associated with lot of errors. Almost 40% error is there, and many studies have already proven that. So whether they have really plotted correct gestational age assessment, it will be leading to lot of errors. And they do not describe longitudinal fetal growth. Means they are just taking cross-sectional immediately after birth, what is the weight of the baby, length of the baby, and head circumference. They will not measure once again how the baby grows longitudinally over many months. And as I have already told you, many of these are done only in developed countries. The characteristic of preterm infants that contributed them also is a question, because as I have already told you, there are many factors which will affect the preterm weight, like PIS, GDM. They have taken such mothers also. They have not taken only the healthy mother, but they have taken even the unhealthy also. And many of these curves, when they try to, once the WHO published their data of the infant charts, they try to match with the WHO. So they try to extrapolate their curve and try to match with the WHO. So it may not be really ideal work. And there are no standardized measurements. And as I was told, included mothers with complications. So there are many factors which will tell, might be a lot of errors in plotting these charts. Many of these errors or the many of these limitation factors have been were taken care. And in this study, I have told you, Intergrowth 21st study, they also, in addition to longitudinal study, they also did the cross-sectional study of the international standards of newborn weight, length, and head circumference by gestational age and sex. This was a cross-sectional data, whatever they have put. So this cross-sectional data, but the problem in this is they have plotted only up to 33 weeks. They have included more preterm, less than 33 weeks. The number of babies for which the growth standards were taken was very less. So they have separately studied in the other, they have supplemented this growth chart with the other study. So some people were telling, okay, we are plotting the babies who are born preterm, but there are many factors which will affect the preterm babies so as to make them deliver early. So these factors will also influence their weight, length, and head circumference. So they told, why can't we have the ultrasound measurements as an ideal? Because once the pregnancy is continuing, we can have the ultrasound measurements so that the it will be the ideal thing. So factors that contribute to premature birth can adversely influence the size at birth, but the only problem is the selection bias, because they thought the babies which are born are having affected weight. That's why we should not be, they are not the ideal one. But this also has limitations. There are measurement errors, because each radiograph radiologist, if you take the if we take the anthropometric measures, the likely weight of the child, it is always different for different radiologists. The fetal length, which is one of the important measurement of the anthropometry, the fetal length, it cannot be measured because the child will be in the flex position. And there are different biological processes which are affecting the fetus and the postnatal. So there are many environmental and nutritional constraints which will be affecting the postnatal baby rather than the fetus. So we should not be taking the fetus as such. So there were limitations with this also. So the intergrowth study, which was published, they tried to find out what are the differences, the longitudinal growth curves and the ultrasound measurements. They found there are a lot of differences, especially if you see in this chart, the less than 30 weeks measurements were not correlating at all. And these are the babies which are, we are more worried, especially less than 34 weeks, we are more worried, because they are the ones we are going to monitor more for the growth of the child. So these also, ultrasound charts also were not accepted by many. So coming to postnatal growth charts. So what are these postnatal growth charts? So they have done, means they will take, after the baby is born, they will take serial measurement of the babies who are growing in the postnatal ward or in the NICU, giving them accurate, means giving them good management, all the things, nutritional management and all. So since many years, this was being done, Berry et al. In 1997, Inkraz in 1999, and the latest one is the Intergrowth 21st 2014. So why they have done this, means why they took this longitudinal measures, why we should not make a intrauterine growth charts? Because they felt the preterm infants, whether they should grow like fetuses. What is the difference between fetuses and the preterm infants? So in a preterm infant is not in any way nutritionally or metabolically or in a, as a fetus. So there are a lot of factors which will affect the fetus, and there are the factors which affect the postnatal growth are entirely different. And over the many years, when they try to make the preterm grow into the like a intrauterine plotting in the intrauterine growth charts, hardly any less than 50% attained the intrauterine growth rate. So whether we are pushing the child who are growing normally, making them more, even if they are growing normally, we are making them, giving more nutritional management, unnecessary nutritional management, and making them to grow abnormally, that is also a question. That's what they were asking. And the main purpose was why we should be making them to grow at a very high pace, so that they have a neurological improved neurological cognition, or the neurological development is normal for them. But all the studies which were done were only observational studies. Even in the Intergrowth 21st study, which are not making the preterm babies to grow as in the intrauterine growth, they also had normal neurodevelopmental outcome. So that I will be discussing. And very preterm infants fed on human milk had accelerated head circumference. So the head circumference was going at a normal pace. Even though their weight is affected, their head circumference is never affected. So during periods of poor postnatal weight gain. So whether really this poor weight gain matters is the question. And pushing the babies to be more overfed it always leads to increased fat accretion, and though the weight is increased, but there is lot of abnormal metabolic tissues, like fat is more absorbed and the higher risk of metabolic and cardiovascular problems later in the life. So these are the so this intergrowth 21st study, they overlap the longitudinal growth with the Fenton charts. As you see, there are a lot of differences, especially in the lower preterms. There are a lot of gaps is there, and they find it's we are pushing the babies to a new abnormal growth. So that is the question what they had put. So that's why they started thinking, the researchers started thinking, okay, we should have a ideal preterm growth chart where we are going to plot a healthy preterm, how it will be going without any effect. So for that, this intergrowth 21st study was done, and it was published in the year 2014. So the postnatal growth chart, so this is a new concept, and the growth target for postnatal growth of preterm infant should be the growth of only healthy preterm. We are not going to for any other thing like intrauterine growth chart rather than the fetus. And postnatal, as I already told you, postnatal environment and the fetus environment is entirely different. So this intergrowth 21st preterm postnatal growth standard was done. It is a both the reference and the standard, because the reference is for some of the aspects. I have told you the number of babies in the lower weeks were very less. That's why they have taken it as a reference, because they have included babies who had little bit risk factors, like mother having PIH and GDM also they had included. Otherwise, most of the babies were grown healthy. So these are the international postnatal growth standards which are published. We can get even in the website. We have many apps also for that. Why this is why this standards means, what are the strength of this growth chart? Because they are well monitored pregnancies. Almost nearly 5,000 pregnancies were monitored. Without these, all mothers were having hardly any risk factors. All the mothers were having no nil risk factors for IUGR or preterm delivery. They had reliable estimation of gestational age. All the mothers had first trimester ultrasound scan, and they had accurate measurement of the gestational age of the baby. There is an agreed international character, means all the mothers were from different parts of the world, both developing countries, developed countries, with all different types of race, the blacks, the Caucasians, the Asians, everyone were involved in this study. And standardized measures were taken from the birth. There are different standard operating procedures, SOPs. The training was given for the persons who are going to measure. And the measurements, the instruments for which the measurements were taken, were all procured from a single company. So there were all standardized procedures were followed. Here, evidence-based care, including the predominant human milk, was given. Infants who developed complications were excluded. Charts available in both centiles and Z-score, because nowadays they are thinking Z-score is much better than the centiles. And as I already told you, it's a prescriptive approach using the WHO. So there are many apps already available in the in the website. In the, if you type intergrowth 21st, you will get the apps. So what are the strengths of this chart? Why we should be following this? Means compared to uterine growth chart, why we should be, what are the strengths which will tell you, okay, this is the ideal one. So when they superimposed the WHO growth chart, they found the the postnatal growth curve intersected with the WHO growth charts in the proper manner. So that when they found if they are taken the measurements at term gestation, term when they turned out to be term, the weight, length, head circumference were almost equal. As you see in this table, they were almost equal to the WHO standard. So when they start the preterm babies, when they started plotting in the curve, they intersected with the exactly with the WHO. Unlike in other intrauterine growth charts, they have to be smoothened. The curves had to be smoothened to make it intersect with the WHO. But here they exactly intersected with the WHO. Not only that, they followed these babies till 2 years of age, and they found the growth rate was very much according to the WHO growth rate. So at 2 years of age, almost all the when they studied the mean with the standard deviation of the weight, height, and the head circumference, they almost matched with the WHO standards at 2 years of age. Not only the growth, even the development. They found the development of these babies were well compared with the normal babies who are born term, and they develop the gross motor milestones. When they compared at 2 years, they found that it's almost equal to the WHO standard. Only 1 month difference was there, but if they took the corrected gestational age, that 1 month also gap was also not there. So even if these babies grew at a lesser rate compared to the intrauterine growth, even then they had good growth and development at 2 years of age. So they did not make the babies to be more nutritional, means even though they were growing normally, they did not make the babies with lot of supplements, lot of formula milk like that. So comparison with Fenton charts, the intrauterine growth charts, it's almost similar, especially there are differences in the lesser weeks, lesser preterm, 27 to 33 weeks, there are a lot of differences. And also, as you see, there are dotted lines in the red dotted lines were there. They made the smoothing of the curves to WHO growth chart. As in any other charts, there are limitations in this also. That's why they are still not being used extensively. What are the limitations of these growth charts? So the main limitation of these growth charts were, these are very much standardized up to 33 weeks of the gestation. Less than 33 weeks, the number of babies were very, very small. Hardly 12 babies, they were able to have the growth standards, how they grew. That's why less than 33 weeks of gestation, we don't know whether the curves are really good or not, we don't know. So this is the main limiting factor of this Intergroup 21 standards. Why this is the main limiting factor is, we are much more worried about the preterm babies who are born extremely preterm, like 28 to 30 weeks. There only we want to have a longitudinal growth, what we call standardized growth. But the standard curves are not available less than 33 weeks of gestation. That's why still many people don't use this Intergrowth 21st standard. Next one is the individualized growth trajectory. This is the newer concept because, as we know, there is a physiological weight loss in any newborn, though whether it is term baby or new preterm baby. Most of this weight loss is contributed by the water loss, extracellular water loss. So once they attain the new target, is after 20, usually preterm babies take more time to attain a target, means take more time for the weight loss to occur. So they will reach a new target since the birth weight increases. To a new target at around 21 days of life. From there, whether they have to start follow the same weight trajectory or they have to follow the they have to follow the birth weight trajectory, or they have to follow the other other trajectories. So they have done the studies here also, and because mainly what happens is, if you ask them to follow the birth weight trajectory, whether it will be amounting to more free what we call abnormal growth, they tried to find out, and they found out we have to take the this after the weight loss, the new trajectory, whatever is found, we have to take that new trajectory to decrease the abnormal fat deposition. So they have done this study also, and they have given individual intrauterine growth for each child. So once you they have given the app, we have to just enter whether the sex of the child, the gestational age, and the gestational age at which we are plotting the chart, and the weight. So they will give you individual trajectory for the individual baby, so to minimize the overgrowth of the child. So this is the new concept, but the limitation still, we don't know whether it is really working with respect to neurodevelopmental outcome or the metabolic effects. They are going to study, and still it is a initial stage. So they are pending investigation. This is a new concept. We have to still wait. So regardless of the preterm selected, preterm gestational age chart is selected before the consensus is sealed. The consensus is to transition to the WHO growth chart. So once whatever the growth charts we are using, once the child is attained a term gestation, corrected gestational age, postmenstrual age, we have to start using the WHO growth charts. That is the recommendation, because the WHO curves are considered the standard for monitoring the longitudinal growth of child from birth to 24 hours. The intergrowth charts, though they were there for even to up to 2 years, but they recommend even the WHO chart itself. Coming to BMI chart, why they included, why we have to plot even the BMI. As I have already told you, the preterm, they are more prone for the abnormal fat deposition, especially the visceral fat. And because the more the visceral fat, the more the abdominal fat it is accreted, the more the metabolic syndromes or the long-term complications will be there. So they had less lean body mass and higher fat mass. So to overcome this, or to find out which babies are having prone for this BMI charts came into existence. So we have BMI charts, but it is still not validated. So longitudinal BMI growth charts are there for surviving preterm. It was published in 2018 in Pediatrics. But still, the study is going on to know what are the effects, whether it is really going to work or not. We have to see in the future. So limitation is failure to identify the major limitation. Whether we can use only the BMI charts? No, because it will not help us to identify if the baby is growing where the both the weight and length are affected simultaneously. In the same direction, if they are affected, it will never tell us, and it will show as a normal curve. And also, BMI is a poor surrogative marker for the abdominal adiposity. Coming to conclusion, so accurate assessment and careful monitoring of the postnatal growth of preterm is needed and essential. None of the preterm growth curves are available or without any limitations. Almost all have limitations, but we have to choose the best among them. After 33 weeks, the intergrowth 21st curves are the prescriptive curves are the best ones, but less than 33 weeks, they are not of much use. Less than 33 weeks, we have to still use the intrauterine growth curve. Intrauterine growth references remains the remains one of the most accepted growth charts. and prenatal, postnatal growth standard that uses the healthy preterm infants as references is now available, but is limited to the small number of very preterm infants used to construct the curves of the lower gestational age. I've already told the postnatal standard curves. They are limited by the less than 30 pg. And tracking body proportionality indexes using BMI curves can potentially optimize long-term health. So this is my presentation. Thank you one and all. Any questions we'll take at the end.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So I would request Dr. Fatehpur to just stop the sharing.
That's good.
Dr. Sunil?
Yes.
You can start sharing your presentation. Share screen. Basic. Share screen. Basic. And press the Dr. Sunil,
it's not too true.
Just to open your PPT in the background, like the way.
Yeah.
Got it?
Yeah, got it.
Share screen, yeah. Go to slide mode. All right. thank you, Dr. Sunil, for joining us as a speaker for the new NNF Karnataka web series. So he will be talking on approach to hypo and hypernatremia, algorithmic approach. So he's a consultant neonatologist at Narayana Health, Shivamogga. So over to you, Dr. Sunil.
Thank you.
All the questions later.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. And good evening, respected seniors, colleagues, and my friends. And it's a very good initiative by the NNF Karnataka, the web series. It's really going to help everyone. Okay. Let's go to my topic after listening to the very difficult and difficult topic of growth charts, which Dr. Fadefar made it very simple. Coming to my topic given was approach to hypo and hypernatremia in neonates. Okay, so let me see how I'll make this topic simple. Okay. Claude Bernard said once, the constancy of internal environment is conditioned to live free and independent life. The mechanism that makes it possible is that which assured the maintenance with internal environment of all the conditions necessary for life of elements. So life goes smooth without much of interference. So as a newborn practitioners, we need to interfere at appropriate time. Okay. Right. So coming to this case, 28-weeker, 900 gram, is at 50 hours of life, is post-surfactant on CPAP of 5 and FiO2 of 40%. So coming to this scenario now, the scenario one, at 50 hours, the baby weighs 880 grams. And the baby is getting 120 ml per kg of total fluids. And urine output of baby is 2.7 ml per kg per hour. And sodium measured was at 135. And the GRPS was at around 100. And creatinine is 0.7. So baby is at 50 hours of life. So what to do? What is the fluid prescription for this baby? So whether it will increase or decrease or will add a sodium because it is completed 48 hours of life. Okay. So similar baby, if the scenario is situation is like this, like the baby is weighing 840 grams and the baby is getting the same amount of fluids and the urine output is 6 ml per kg per hour and sodium is 148. GRPS is 180.
Dr. Sunil, I think the background, a lot of traffic noise is there. I think it's better you close the thing, window.
Sorry?
from background, lot of traffic noise is coming. Can you
just
close the doors? It's okay, close the doors and use hands free.
Just use my microphone.
It's better now. It's better. Yes.
Hello?
Yeah, it's audible. Please proceed.
It's audible? Yeah. Okay. So coming to the same baby, if the situation is the baby is weighing 840 grams and total fluid of 120 ml per kg baby is getting and urine output of 6 ml per kg per hour and sodium is 148, ARBS is 180 and creatinine is 0.8. So what is with the fluid prescription, whether to add or anything we need, any attention is required. Okay, so let me see. Okay, so what is this sodium? This sodium, the measured sodium is, the sodium depends on the total body sodium content and also the water. What is the levels of water solution level? So the measured sodium is relative to the concentration. What is the content of water? How much water the body has? What the unit has? So it is relative to water only the sodium concentration is measured. So that's why it is the unit used is sodium is used is milliequivalent per liter or millimoles per liter. It is always based on the water content. So it's always measured based relative to water. So whenever the water goes down, so measured sodium will be high, and when it is water levels are high, the measured sodiums will be low. Okay, so body fluid is a mixture of solute and solvent, and sodium is the predominant cation in the extracellular fluid, and sodium is the one which exerts the highest tonicity to the plasma or extracellular fluid, and osmolality is nothing but it's a solute particles per weight of solvent, and any change in this osmotic equilibrium, there is a water shift from lower to high osmolality. So how to assess the fluid status of a neonate or the fluid and sodium status of a neonate? Okay, we have to assess first the hydration and volume status, then we need to know the fluid balance, whether is fluid excessive, baby is losing excess of fluids or it is retaining fluids, and we should know the perfusion. Okay, so how to assess the hydration and volume status? So hydration volume status can be assessed clinically, but the clinical accuracy is not that much great. Clinically, we can assess by the anterior fontanelle and skin turgor and the mucosa. And nowadays, the echo is being part of everyone is doing their NICUs, and echo and the central venous pressures measurement very clearly give us the volume status, whether baby is in hypovolemic or hypovolemic. Then how to know the fluid balance status? So fluid balance status we can know by the weight trend and what is the fluid input and what is the fluid output baby is having. Based on that, we can know the fluid balance, whether it is a positive or negative. And premature babies, because of immature skin, renal and neuroendocrine systems, it's very difficult for premature babies to have a sustained water balance. Then perfusion can be assessed by measuring the blood pressure, capillary refill time, urine output, and core and peripheral body temperature difference, CVP can be measured. Basically, the perfusion will get affected because of cardiac and dysfunction and sepsis. Okay, so how to achieve a normal sodium and fluid balance? It's been known to everyone that immediately after birth, the baby will lose, there will be something called as physiological diuresis. So we need to allow this physiological isotonic contraction of extracellular fluid to have a balanced sodium and fluid balance. And this ECF contraction is, and usually this ECF contraction is achieved by 2 to 5 days of life, and usually it can be it will be known by weight loss of around 5% baby weight loss and increase in the urine output. These are the clues where we can see the physiological isotonic contraction has been achieved. And ECF contraction is delayed in RDS and early sodium introduction before this ECF contraction is associated with the increased respiratory morbidity. There has been clear link with increased water requirement, and also it increases the risk of BPD. And even in PDA, it is not the water, it is the sodium, early introduction of sodium, which is going to enhance the reopening of PDA, and even it increases the risk of NEC. And as I told, it's immature skin and renal function and neuroendocrine system makes the fluid balance challenging in premature babies. Okay. So where we need to focus then, where we need to focus and act appropriately. So to achieve a proper sodium and water balance, we need to concentrate basically on this, especially in the premature babies, we need to minimize as much as possible this insensible water loss. Use plastic wraps at birth for premature babies, and use resuscitation under the warmer, and use incubator, transport incubator while transporting, and use incubators with humidity around 80 to 90% of humidity. So by these, we can minimize the, and yeah, also use the micro environment. Minimize the insensible water loss. Then we need to facilitate the loss of ECF as explained previous slide. So we should not interfere that physiological process. It has to go smoothly. Then only we can achieve a stable sodium and water balance. Then we need to maintain a glucose hemostasis. A glucose is also an osmotically active particle. The higher the glucose serum levels, they can enhance the osmotic diuresis. Then we need to optimize the nutrition support also. So from day one, we can start TPN, and when there is, should always start enteral feed. Then we need to maintain the renal perfusion. Even in premature babies, the autonomic system is immature. So they may need some small dose of inotropic support also that can be used to maintain the adequate renal perfusion. Okay. So coming to this disorders of sodium. So disorder of sodium can be classified basically or based on the volume status. So before that volume status, we can classify also as isometric dehydration, where there is an equivalent loss of both sodium and water, where it usually happens during the drainage, like thoracostomy, nasogastric and ventriculostomy drainage, and third space loss like peritonitis, gastroparesis, and omphalocele. In this, the both sodium and water is lost, so the serum tonicity is maintained. Even the serum, so measured serum sodium can be normal, but only the clue will be the weight loss and the visible electrolyte rich that in the drainage, which is what we can see in nasogastric or ventriculostomy. So that will be the clue. So where equal quantity of lost electrolytes and water needs to be placed. Then something called as factitious hyponatremia or pseudohyponatremia, where the sodium may be normal, but because of some other osmotic, increased osmotically active particles like lipid, glucose, mannitol, we will see decreased measured sodium. So that is called as factitious hyponatremia or pseudohyponatremia. Then, so hyponatremia, then they can also be classified based on the extracellular volume, either due to depleted extracellular volume, normal, and excess of ECF volume. So what are the conditions like? So basic etiology for ECF depletions are either it has to deplete through renal or it has to go through extrarenal. So the etiologies may be a diuretic use and then VW renal and sodium wasting and start losing congenital adrenal hypertrophy and renal tubular disorders and GI loss because of vomiting and diarrhea and third space loss. So how will you assess this condition? So, hydration and volume status, fluid balance and perfusion. in these three headings, let us assess the situation. So what happens to the hydration? So because there is a loss of water and sodium also, so the volume status is reduced and the baby will be dehydrated. And fluid balance is negative. Baby lose the weight, and perfusion is compromised because the volume status is also reduced. So perfusion is also compromised. Okay. So coming to the hyponatremia with the normal ECF value, where we can expect the normal ECF value with hyponatremia? With hyponatremia, is one is excess of fluid administration, and another one is SIDH and loss of formula, which is very diluted formula for longer periods. If you give, that can also cause hyponatremia with a normal extracellular fluid. So here, the hydration will be normal because the ECF volume is maintained. And fluid balance here, because of excess fluids and SIDH, the baby gains weight. But in SIDH, there will be no visible edema as such. Then perfusion will be normal. Okay. Then coming to hyponatremia with excess of ECF volume. So in early stages of heart failure and sepsis, and in neuromuscular blockade and abnormal lymphatic drainage, we'll see these are the etiology for the hyponatremia with excess of volume. So because of this, the ECF will be expanded, okay? And there will be baby gains some weight and perfusion will be reduced. Okay. So this is what I told, this is based on clinical assessment, and this is algorithmic approach to an hyponatremia. This basically we need to assess here plasma osmolality, urine osmolality, and urine sodium. So these three numericals we need to know for this algorithm. And so if the baby's normal neonatal sodium is 135 to 145, so if any less than 135, we need to do a plasma osmolality. If it is reduced, osmolality is reduced, and if it is more than 280, if it is more than 280, there are some any other osmotically active molecules like either hyperglycemia or mannitol. So that is pseudo hyponatremia. So that way the algorithm goes once and it ends here. Then if the plasma osmolality is reduced, is like less than 280, then we need to check urine osmolality, whether the urine is concentrated urine or less concentrated urine. So if the urine osmolality reduced means the less concentrated urine, that can be because of excess of water intake. If the urine concentration is more high color urine, or urine osmolality is more than 100 millimoles per kg of water, if it is associated with hypovolemia, reduced volume, that can be because of this all the salt and water depletion, like it can be renal or extra renal. How to differentiate is based on urine sodium. If it is less than 20, it is extra renal. If it is more than 20, it will be renal loss. Then concentrated with hypovolemia, there it can be either it may be because of renal causes or SIDH, syndrome of inappropriate SIDH. Okay. If urine is renal causes, again you can differentiate based on the urinary sodium, more than 20 or less than 20. Okay. So next, coming to hypernatremia. So hypernatremia also, there also we can differentiate based on the volume status, based on ECF volume status. Okay. So hypernatremia with normal or deficient ECF volume. So what are the conditions? Like it can be because of in the excessive water loss, insensible water loss through renal, or insensible water loss in premature babies, or poor feeding. So here the baby water has gone, so the baby will be dehydrated and the volume status is reduced, and there will be negative fluid balance, and perfusion is decrease based on the severity of the illness. Then hypernatremia with excess of ECF volume. So this happens in case of where the sodium and water levels both are increased. So here the etiologies can be because of the usage of excess 3% NS, soda bicarbonate, concentrated formulas, and even in CCF late stages there can be hypernatremia with the excess of ACF expansion. So here the volume status is expanded, fluid balance positive, the baby gains weight, and perfusion is can be normal, but in CCF perfusion can be compromised except for CCF. Okay. So coming back to this, Mike, the first case, the 28 week or 900 grams at 50 years of life, post surfactant on CPAP 5 and FI to 40%. Okay. So what is the inference? Okay. So here the weight loss is only 2%, and baby is getting 108, and it is throwing only, its urine output is only 58 ml. So even though it is 50 hours, it's still not attained the complete ECF contraction. It is inadequate. So at this juncture, adding a sodium is not at all a good decision. And because the balance appears to be okay, like you can continue the same IV fluids, like 120 ml per kg of fluids can be continued. Okay. Then coming to this scenario two, where the urine output is more and sodium is also increased. And one thing it catches our eye is the sugar values. It's also at higher side. So the baby has lost more weight, 6.6% of weight loss, and baby is diluting, like it's 108 and 130 is the output. And it is a hypernatremia due to excess fluid loss. It's maybe because of the renal and even the insensible water loss. And also the sugar also is adding to the loss of water. So we need to control the fluid, and here we need to increase the fluids. So fluid replacement is required depending on the weight loss. Okay. Okay. Like coming to this another scenario, a term male baby with perinatal asphyxia was noted to have an edema on day 3 of life. His urine output was normal, and anterior frontonia was full. And hydration normal, and had convulsions, and it's a convulsion on day 3 of life. So fresh convulsion on day 3 of life may not be due to basic pathology asphyxia per se. So what will be the assessment? So here the hydration is normal, then fluid balance is positive, baby has gained some weight, and perfusion appears normal. So what will be the possible diagnosis here? So it's a And sodium, when we measure, it's 120 and it's low. It's hyponatremia with normal ECF. So it's because the background history of perinatal asphyxia, there can be a possibility of SIADH. So we need to act SIADH by reducing the IV fluids. So case scenario two, again, one more case scenario. This late preterm born by LSS comes to NICU on day 10 of life with excessive irritability, voracious feeding attempts, and decreased and high colored urine. On examination, baby is dehydrated, jaundiced, which is the all the neonatologists and practicing pediatricians will see such type of cases routinely in their offices. So here the hydration volume is volume status is low, and baby has lost weight, and perfusion is reduced. So it's a case of hypernatremic dehydration, and sodium measured is 150. Okay. So I think I made the approach clear. Then treatment wise, it's basically the water replace. Basically, it's a water and sodium replacement depending on the situation. Then sodium correction should do it very slowly. Like it should be at a rate of 0.5 milliequivalent per hour. And formula for the free fluid calculation is this is the formula which is used, and for the sodium deficit, this is the formula used. And we need to know our IV fluids before we do the free prescriptions. So usually the 3% NaCl contains 514 milliequivalents. If it comes to each ml, will be around 0.5 milliequivalents each ml. Then NS, it will be 0.15 milliequivalent per ml. Okay, so that is this one. Okay, so that there I finishes my talk. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil. So you can post all your questions. I think there are many questions that has already come. I request Dr. Sohil.
Yes.
Yeah. Start the moderation. You can keep posting the questions. First of all, yeah. Thank you very much. Both the topics were very tough. Thank you, Dr. Fatehpur, and thank you, Dr. Sunil. Over to you, Dr. Sohil.
Yeah. Thank you very much. It was really nice, informative talk by both Dr. Fatehpur and Dr. Sunil. There are a few questions. Dr. Fatehpur went on very nicely from history, then to importance of growth charts, and then the intrauterine growth charts, and then even to the ultrasound measures and everything. One question was to Dr. Fatehpur that they wanted to you to share the link for Intergrowth 21. If you
go to website and just type Intergrowth 21st, it will take you to that website. So there's no need to share the link as such. If you want, I will definitely do that.
Okay. And then the next thing was, after hearing all the growth charts, there was a question like, at the end of the talk, what chart would you like us to use in the NICU?
In the NICU, actually, as of now, we are more concerned about the more
preterm babies.
Very preterm babies, mainly less than 32 weeks or less than 30 weeks. The Intergrowth 21st charts, as of now, they are not validated for less than 33 weeks. So we have to continue to use these Penton charts. It's better to use the local intrauterine growth charts if they are available. In India, we had in 2011, one article was published in 2011, where they have taken a single from a sources of the data was from a single center. Dr. Srinivas Murthy and et al. Had published that growth curve. But the problem is they had taken the data from whatever the people who have entered. So it was a retrospective study. Still, they have told we can use that charts. We can use the local charts given by Dr. Srinivas Murthy. Only that charts are available, intrauterine growth charts. The other one is the Penton charts, which are multicentric. They are done and much more validated than other charts. You can use the Penton charts, or the other option is the Indian charts.
Okay, thank you very much. Then next question we had to Dr. Sunil. Dr. Sunil, there were questions of this thing, like how do you check for urine output in female newborns?
The ideal will be the catheterized sample, but what we usually the routine practice in the NICU is the diaper weight. Even in my experience, we can have a very good fluid balance even with the diaper weight also. That can be followed. Okay. But ideal is catheterization. Ideal if the baby is very sick and if it is already we have documented electrolyte disturbance or documented hypernatremia or hyponatremia, there where we need to check monitor the continuously the urine output, it's better to catheterize and monitor the urine output.
Okay. And there was one question regarding when you spoke about SIDH, that how many days after asphyxia do you think of SIDH? How early can you see SIDH in asphyxia cases?
Because this ECF contraction is occurring, so usually after day 3 only we can expect the SIDH after 48 hours.
There was one request regarding management of severe hypernatremia. You have dealt with it, like you said that you don't want to go faster than 0.5 ml equivalents per hour. But again, they had asked that, how do you like to manage severe hypernatremia?
Okay. So, because the time constraint, I reduced my slides in the treatment scope. See, hypernatremia basically can be classified based on the values like 145 to 145 to 150 is called as mild, and 150 to 170 is moderate, and more than 170 is classified as very severe. So 145 to 150, if the baby is already taking enteral feed, only enteral feeds, we can just enhance the enteral enteral volume of the feeds. And if it is more than 150, then we need to just check the what is the fluid requirement, what is the water deficit, and based on that we have to replace the water. And the IV fluid used should be should always be the isotonic to the what is the baby's levels of sodium. Depending on that, we need to choose the fluid. So in moderate, we can use either half DNS or 1/4 NS can be used. And in case of more than 170 is the very difficult situation to handle as such. It's very rare we'll get the case. In that case, even usage of 0.9% will be hypotonic solution if the baby's sodium levels are 170. In that case, we need to prepare our own IV fluid where the IV fluid concentration should be around 10 to 15 milliequivalents lower than the what the baby's present sodium levels. That is the main caution we need to check.
There was a question like in case of acute kidney injury, and if the suppose the sodium levels are 180, how would you proceed?
Okay, acute kidney injury, sodium levels are 180.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, it's a any other details or only that much? Like?
No, that was all what was asked. Probably it was they wanted to ask for an asphyxiated baby might be the scenario. I they have not asked that, but I feel that could be the scenario.
Okay, so this baby is having a 180 of this one and acute kidney injury. Okay, acute kidney injury. Okay. So basically, the here we renals are affected. Okay, the renal is affected. So we need to restrict the fluid. We need to have a very restricted IV fluid because the renals are affected. And because the sodium levels are 180, we can use the solution less than 10 or 15 milliequivalent. Like 180 means it will come to around 165. So we have to prepare our own solution. And what is the day of life if the baby? What is the day of life?
No, they've not given the day of life. Okay. But my major worry was how to prevent rapid fall in the sodium levels.
No, that is what we need to prepare our own solution. Like we have to use the sterile water and 3% NS we have to take, and we have to prepare the solution so that it. I told I 1 ml of 3% NS is equal to 0.5 ml milliequivalent per kg. And So based on that, we need to prepare. That's a very critical situation I don't have a personal experience with any of the seniors.
I think once the child goes for renal failure, we have to have individualized treatment. So it cannot be a blanket like treatment for all the babies. So we have to calculate the amount of fluid to be given, amount of sodium to be given, like that.
We need to have a detailed history, like what is the cardiac, like based on my assessment, like we need to know the volume status as such, what is the perfusion status, then what is the fluid, based on that only we can have a fluid prescription for these children.
I agree.
These babies, sorry.
Thank you very much. These are all the questions which had come from our since we have had around almost participants today. Thank you very much for your valuable talks. You are very patient enough in answering all the questions with all the dilutions. Thank you very much. Over to you, Dr. Prashant Gowda.
Yeah, thank you. Sir, Dinakar sir, would you like to add anything?
Yes, sir. Dr. Sohail Ambi, with your permission, can I take? There are so many questions left. Can I take? Can
please,
I ask
please.
My speaker?
Please go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, there is one Umesh Kurana. I think so, from North, I don't know from where. Okay. He has asked many questions like that. What is that questions he has asked? Since Intergrowth charts have been developed meticulously with international sampling of non-complicated mothers, better to use Intergrowth charts beyond 34 weeks. These charts merge precisely with WHO task 2. I don't know how he is telling. What about the speaker, Dr. S.R. Fatehpur?
Sir, if the baby is, preterm baby you are monitoring, if it is more than 33 weeks, better to use the intergrowth charts. But less than 33 weeks, because of the very less sample they had got, they are not precise. So we don't know what will happen next. So better to use for babies less than 33 weeks, we should continue to use the intrauterine growth chart. I'm not for the intergrowth 21st standards.
Sir, can I, in case if you don't mind, can I, yes. Can I add something, sir?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Yasar Fatehpur, Dr.
Please, sir.
Okay. Sir, it is because there are few people are still logging in. Many people are logging in. So for them, we will make it life very easy. It is like this. Intergrowth 21 chart can be used from 27 week to 64 week. That is the only chart. Once again, I'm telling, intergrowth chart can be used from 27 to 64 week. After that, they tell go ahead with the WHO chart, because this chart is the only chart is showing postnatal growth dip. Postnatal growth dip. That is one advantage, sir. Then this is also used for 27 means premature babies, extreme premature babies. Then Fenton's chart also, that is also for a premature baby. Only lacuna in this is there is no postnatal growth dip in this. Both are longitudinal chart. Fenton's chart is used from 22 weeker to 50 weeker. 22 weaker. That is one advantage. So somebody has asked one question, Fatehpur sir.
Yes,
can
sir.
We shift that chart from intergrowth chart to Fenton's chart? Somebody has asked, I don't know what is his name. Okay, anyhow, he has asked, can I shift it, sir? No, sir, you cannot shift it because intergrowth chart, even though 27 weaker, that shows dip. But this one is 22 weaker. You cannot, because it is not showing, you cannot dip because there are more than 180 to 290 gram weight difference is coming. That is the studies are there, sir. Yes. Then there is one more question is there, sir. That is regarding the weight growth for the premature baby. Any baby will grow after whatever the corrected age of 41 week, we can use a WHO chart, sir. Sir, there is one more question for the what are the management options for SIADH? Dr. Sunil.
If the baby is asymptomatic, then we can use only the restricted fluids, and we need to concentrate on what fluid we are using. We should usage of too much of hypotonic fluid should be avoided as much as possible. And if the baby is symptomatic, like if it is throwing convulsions, then there are some studies where they have used the Lasix and 3% NS, Lasix and 3% NS infusion simultaneously, where the Lasix can wash out the extra sodium, so that treatment modality can be used. Put Lasix 6 early and 3% NS infusions, 1 to 2 ml per kg.
Yeah. Okay, number one, Dr. SR, the same one more, once again, Murali Rajan, why can't we use WHO chart after 50 weeks as intergrowth merges well?
Sir, I have already told, from
yes,
not
sir.
50 weeks, even we have to shift
41
to we have to shift to WHO growth chart from 40 weeks itself. Not
yes,
even
sir. 41
weeks.
Weaker, we can chart. Yes, sir.
We
correct,
can shift
sir.
To, because the WHO are much more standardized, WHO charts, much more standardized and well accepted, well validated also.
Okay, there is one more question for Sunil. If on day 2, baby's weight same as previous day or higher weight than day 1, then should the total fluid requirement be the same or as a previous day or something change? Dr. Sunil.
Okay, weight remains same.
Yeah. On day two, baby's weight is either higher than the first day or same. What we should do? We should either increase the fluids or what we should do? That is a question from Abdul Khalil.
Okay.
Khalif.
So what I have explained in my slides, we see fluid balance is we do based on many criteria. The clinically one is the urine output and intake and output balance, like what is the urine output and the serum sodium levels and the weight trend. So depending on this, so here the weight has remained same and we don't know urine output here and what is the sodium levels we need to know. So here there is a positive, like baby weight has remained same. Where the physiologically there has to be weight loss, but here the baby weight has remained same. There is water, the baby is retaining the water. So what about the what is the present? We need to just recheck what is the fluid yesterday we have given before increasing. Then we need to know the what is the sodium levels. What are the GRBS levels? So depending on that, we can judge. So because the weight has remained same, we need to just recheck whether we have given excess of fluids or whether the renals are what is the urine output, like whether there is any onset of renal failure, anything like that. So based on that, we can increase or decrease the fluids.
Yes, sir. One more question for same Sunil. Hypernatremia in exclusively breastfed baby. Is there any data suggesting high sodium content in mother's milk? Yes, this is the cause.
Yeah, this has been observed. Yeah, quite healthy babies who are only on breastfeeds, they have been come up with hypernatremia. So what is the possible mechanism? What few case reports is, it is the in the general sodium intake by the mother, with the high sodium intake by the mother, which increases the breast milk sodium content. That is the etiology or that is the factor which causes this silent hypernatremia in these babies.
Okay, then there is a shift. I think so. Does cerebral pontine myelinosis is seen in newborns? Dr. Amit Suyola from North India.
Oh, okay.
Sunil.
Yes, sir. To be frank, I not searched too much literature review regarding this. I think any of the seniors, if they know, they can just throw some light on this.
I don't know. Anybody knows anything, please? Cerebral pontine. Dr. Prashant?
Hello.
Dr. Prashant?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you unmute? Any seniors are there? Anybody knows this? Does cerebral pontine myelinosis is seen in newborn?
Someone has raised the hands. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Anybody lifted the hand? Hello? Anybody lifted the hand?
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Hello, Dr. Dhunkar. I am Dr. Vijay Sharma from Kolkata. Hello?
Yes, sir. Please tell me, sir.
Go ahead. Sir, I want to mention two or three things. One thing is that
yes, sir.
Hypernatremic dehydration is there. That's why our speaker, we cannot connect more than 15 mg equivalent per liter per day. That means 0.5 mg equivalent per deciliter per hour. So what happens, sometimes even due to the type connection, it may not happen. What might happen, in case of if you do more pre-water connection, what might happen, there may be hyponatremia, and that may baby may throw seizure, and this very often happens. In that case, many of us do mistakes, we give ganoperidol. In that case, we have to give hypertonic saline. Similarly, if we do not correct correctly, then cerebral pontine hemorrhage can occur. So the one of the most important things that what we should see when we correct the hyponatremic dehydration, we should do a very tight correction. And tight correction, even though you do the correct correction, sometimes will happen your sodium level will go very down. And if the sodium level goes down, in that case, even if it is hyperlateral dehydration, you have to take 3% sodium fluoride. And that might kill the baby. Sir, I want to make some few comments on asphyxia and fluid therapy. In most of the baby in prenatal asphyxia, you will find that day 2, day 3, the sodium level will be low. And who do mistake, what will give? We give more sodium. We don't should not give more sodium. We just exit the fluid. And many a times in our clinical practice, we don't do sodium every day. If the baby is passing urine, just restrict the fluid. Sometimes what happens, baby might develop AKI. If the baby develops AKI, whatever is the sodium, just be insensible water loss. And we will find after 2 or 3 days, baby's urine will come out. But the mistake is done when there is low sodium. Sometimes it can happen even 118, 110, 112 like that. Don't get afraid. What you should do, just restrict the sodium. Give only insensible water loss and volume to volume correction, like urine output. And volume to volume correction, if you can give sodium half normal saline. Another question that
Sir, one second. Prashant?
Hello?
Tell me, sir.
Yeah. Does cerebral pontine myelinosis is seen in newborns? Anybody knows anything?
Anybody can answer? It can happen, but it is rarely happens. It can happen.
Okay, sir, everybody listening, because 115 members are there still. So it can happen, sir, because I was not knowing. Okay, thank you very much, sir.
Hello?
Okay. How do we avoid, Dr. Sunil, rapid fall in sodium? Dr. Sunil?
Hello?
Dr. Sunil?
Hello?
Prashant?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Sunil is there?
Yeah, Dr. Sunil is there. Sunil is there.
How do we avoid rapid fall of sodium?
Sir, can I answer this question?
Yes, sir, please.
Actually, you can avoid sodium correction, rapid fall in sodium by tightly calculating the sodium free water calculation when you are treating a baby hyperlactinic diabetes. So, yeah. What happens? It might happen sodium may go up to 145 to 150. So what I do in my clinical practice, if it is 145 to 150, just increase the fluid. There is no need of doing any pre-water correction. If the sodium level is 150 to 170, you cannot correct more than 15 kilojoules per day. And for that, we have needed calculation. Yes, because I don't have time, I cannot show you the calculation, how the calculation should be made. As the speaker has rightly pointed out, most of the time, even with the calculation, it will come around half normal saline or 1/4 normal saline. So what we have to give the normal maintenance requirement and the free water correction. And free water correction should not be very fast. It should be not be corrected more than 15 millivolt per day, per liter per day. Even if you do the try correction, we have to regularly check the sodium level. Sometimes what happens, even if you do correction after people 24 sodium level may be very low. In that case, you have to reduce your correction further. Even after that, sometimes it might happen because of your rapid correction, baby may throw seizure. In that particular situation, in the crisis period, you can give 3% sodium chloride. If you give 3% sodium chloride, the performance will disappear. So it is very easy to say, but you should have a very careful watch on the sodium level when you're starting the correction. And also you should know how to calculate the free water correction. As just 1 minute time. What has been, suppose the sodium is 160. So I should correct from 140 to 145 to 160, that is 15 millivolt. As the speaker says that you can multiply 0.6 into 48 into 60. That much of sodium you can correct. So that in this calculation, unless you can show in the slide that the participant will not be able to understand. This is the main problem of hyperlactinic dehydration. It might happen in a baby who is losing fluid, like there is no water feeding. So
what I do
in my clinical practice. So if you see another book, I can refer you, Harriet Lane. So what happens, suppose a baby comes to me at day 30 of life. What happens if the baby comes at day 30 of life, we know that up to 10 days of life, baby may lose 10 or 15% weight loss. Suppose that baby loses 30% weight loss. Actually, that calculation will be not based on 30% because we know in normal world, baby can lose up to 10 or 15% after day 15. So in that particular case, we have to take 15% weight loss. That is not written in the Harriet lab. That the students or the participants have to understand. So if you give an opportunity, I can show you the calculation. I will mail the calculation, how to calculate the free water correction. Because hypernatremia diagnosis is not very difficult. Anybody can diagnose. But how to calculate the free fluid, that is the crux. People cannot calculate the free fluid correctly, as we have rightly pointed out that the rapid fall of sodium and that may be
yes.
consequence may be seizure. And that is another thing is that when there is slow seizure and if the sodium level is very low, in that particular case, we have to add 3% sodium chloride, not phenobarbital, another drug. That is the mistake we do. Another important thing, when you get a patient of hypernatremic dehydration, if you see that urea and creatinine, it will be very, very high. And we do mistakes. So even the urea creatinine is very high, also this is urea creatinine is very high because there is dehydration. Once you start correcting dehydration, this will pass urine. So that is, as we have rightly mentioned, but it is beyond my capacity actually to tell how to do a free water correction. I will send you a mail, you can submit to the participant.
Yes, sir. Bhaijan Shah, Bhaijan sir, sir.
I know that you are from West Bengal.
Very nice, sir. Very nice. Sir, okay. I think so, Dr. Prashant?
Yes, sir.
Anybody wants to talk anything, please give the chance to all the people.
You can I think Guru Prasad sir wanted to say something.
Okay, anybody wants to talk, please let them talk.
Yeah, I think Prashant, I think Fatehpur did a great job, and it's a very difficult topic, growth monitoring charts. I think over 30 years, we have not been able to really precisely tell this is the ideal growth chart for growing preterm babies. Unfortunately, we need to depend still on the Western charts. And you did a good literature review of the available charts and which are ideal. I think there are a lot of fellows and other SRs who are studying in different places. This is one area the residents can just plan having their own follow-up and derived charts. Otherwise, it's nicely discussed. What is the ideal chart? Still a million-dollar question. I think that is something we don't have very strong evidence-based guidelines for that. And somebody posed a question. I think Dinakar should try to find an answer. What does the NNF recommend as far as growth monitoring of preterm is concerned? Even in NNF central guidelines book, we have not addressed this issue in the last two issues. And yes. Sunil, I think your presentation was good. And I think what everybody should remember now in the pandemic of COVID, we have an epidemic of hypernatremia, especially in the central districts and in the northern districts of Karnataka. And an average every other day, one baby gets admitted with low milk transfer, dyselectrolytemia, significant postnatal weight loss. Right in the morning, I did a rounds and the sodium was 192. Weight loss is 800 grams. This is not uncommon. And last week we had a newborn, we doubly checked these serum sodium values. So what is very important is ensure feeding and how to prevent hypernatremia at this hour of crisis. Ensure and encourage mother to drink plenty of fluids and frequently breastfeed. As you said, silent hypernatremia in exclusively breastfed infants is very common. Only thing you should closely monitor these infants. Otherwise, and the correction of sodium has to be done pretty slowly and methodically. Fortunately, prognosis is excellent. Very patiently, you have to do it over 48 to 72 hours. I think both of you did good job. And that's it, Prashant, from my side.
Yep. Dr. Dinkala, just have one of the about the phantom chart for preterm.
Yes,
if you those who are using phantom chart, if you see, if you plot baby's growth in the phantom chart, most of the babies, their weight will fall below the reference standard actually. Because these are the charts made based on the baby's growth in the weight. And second important thing, I think all of the participants and neurologists agree with me, most of the preterm and ill-developed infants, they will have some comorbidities when they are born. So that is why most of the babies, when they go home at 36 weeks or 40 weeks, they will go with extracellular growth restriction. That is the biggest problem. And the phantom growth chart is because this growth chart is based on the babies who are born in the waist. That is why if we plot our babies' weight in the phantom growth chart, we find most of them will fall below the reference standard, and most of them will go wrong with extracellular growth restriction. Another important thing is that in the phantom chart, the comorbidities like necrotizing enterocolitis, testes, intraventricular hemorrhage, these are not been considered. But in NN transplant, this has been considered. But you will agree with me, most of our babies will have this comorbidities. Another, in my practice, in our practice, what we do up to 40 weeks, we use Pendol. And after 40 weeks, we do WSO. Another point for the participant, WSO growth chart starts with 40 weeks of gestation. The zero, what it starts, that zero means baby has attained the 40 weeks. Just remember. After that, it will go. As the speaker has given an excellent presentation of intrafast growth standard, it smooths with WSO growth chart from 40 weeks onwards. But in our practice, what we are using Fenton up to 40 weeks, and after 40 weeks, we are using WSO. But that is the problem of Fenton. Another problem with Fenton is that the postnatal dip is not there. So in the past week of life, it will fall further below the reference curve. And after 1 week, it will go up, but it will never cross more than 10 centimeters. That is what I wanted to tell you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. Prashant?
Yeah, yeah.
Prashant,
think... yes, sir.
Please,
yes, sir.
Can you tell about tomorrow's thing, please?
Yeah, tomorrow is the International Kangaroo Mother Care Day, May 15th. It has been marked and celebrated as International Kangaroo Mother Care Day. In association with UNICEF, it has been doing a lot of work in terms of kangaroo mother care, to promote kangaroo mother care. We from NNF Karnataka chapter are joining hands with them, and then we are celebrating. So tomorrow we have talks on kangaroo mother care. So three renowned, well-renowned speaker, Dr. Shashivani. She has done tremendous work and dedicated her entire life for kangaroo mother care and for the lactation. And she has done tremendous work in uplifting the community. She will be talking on kangaroo mother care and community, how it goes hand in hand. Plus, we have an introduction, inaugural mark by Dr. Sanjeev, who has been at the highest level from India in UNICEF in Kangaroo Mother Care Foundation. And we have Secretary of KMC Foundation, Dr. Somshekhar Nimbalkar, who will be talking on kangaroo mother care and brain development or brain stimulation. Plus, we have Dr. Krishna, who is a Telangana consultant for UNICEF. For the state, he'll also be talking on kangaroo mother care. So it's going to be a feast, and everything you want to know about the latest and the recent advances, recent updates which has been done in kangaroo mother care, not just the procedure what we all know, beyond the routine methods of doing the kangaroo mother care, what are the other advantages, will be discussed in detail. I request all of you to join, and please tell your friends, colleagues, and all the nursing staff who are part of NICU Care to be a part of this program. Tomorrow we're going to start sharp at 5 o'clock, 5:10 exactly. So please do join us. Thank you. Thank you very much for all the speakers, Dr. Fatehpur, Dr. Sunil, Dr. Soel, and all the seniors and participants who have participated.
Not only that, Prashant, all yes. The joint secretaries, because of their help,
and
at the same time, speakers virtue. Many people are logging in. Thank you, Fatehpur, Sunil, Suhail, all the speakers, Bijan, Dr. Guruprasad sir, Putresh sir, everybody, thank you, sir. Everybody, thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, sir.